So good evening, and it's a privilege and joy to welcome you all to this launch of the Center for Ecclesial Ethics at the Margaret Beaufort Institute of Theology in Cambridge. A very special welcome to our distinguished speaker, Professor James Keenan. So my name is Anna Abram. I'm co-principal of the Margaret Beaufort Institute. And my role today, apart from welcoming you, is to mention a couple of practical points and say a few words about the Institute. So first, may I please request that you keep your microphones switched off during the whole event? And secondly, we are recording Professor Keenan's lecture, and we will make it available on the Institute's YouTube channel. A few words about the Institute. We are a Roman Catholic member of Cambridge Theological Federation, which is a body of 12 institutions representing different Christian denominations and one interfaith organization. Our institute offers courses that range from ethics and philosophical theology to pastoral practice, spirituality, and theological reflection to students of all levels, doctoral, master's, diploma, and certificate. We also teach short enrichment courses, lead retreats, and resource schools, parishes, hospitals, and prisons, with expertise, training, and pastoral support. We are a small team of staff, but with a big community of research fellows and associates, currently 34. And we provide sabbatical and research fellowship opportunities. We are home to the Religious Life Institute, and we work closely with our on-site partners, Lynn's House, a community of those with and without learning difficulties, Cambridge Center for Applied Research in Human Trafficking, and Kirby Lang Center for Public Theology. We describe ourselves as a place of formation, and we are told by those who study with us that for many, the Institute is a place of transformation. The Institute constantly grows and develops. The establishment of the Center for Ecclesial Ethics is a significant moment in our life. So now it is my great pleasure to hand over to my colleague, Dr. Liam Hayes, Director of the Center for Ecclesial Ethics, to say a few words about the center. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna. Thank you, Anna. I hope you can hear me, everyone. And welcome once again to each and every one of you. We are delighted that you have joined us for this inaugural lecture of the Center for Ecclesial Ethics, in which we will shortly explore with Professor Jim Keenan the different church that might be realized through an embrace of an ecclesial ethics of vulnerability. But as Anna mentioned, before we begin our journey this evening with Jim, I'd like to open up for us the wider context in which the Center for Ecclesial Ethics began its journey, a context that shaped and informed the development of our focus and discernment. In the early weeks of 2020, as we were reflecting upon how to launch the center, the COVID-19 pandemic engulfed our world. The ensuing months would consume us in waves of suffering and trauma, injustice and isolation, amidst an emergence of tenderness and compassion, solidarity and hope that revealed anew both the beauty of humanity and who was truly key to our flourishing across our communities. Yet within this time of tumult and confusion, as we began to ponder a new way, to ponder a new normal of inclusion and interconnectedness, new possibilities and new leaders emerged to guide us in our communities and lead us across some of our church, revealing perhaps the newness that God might be suggesting. So today, although it remains a time of deep disruption and trauma for our world and our church, we have been exposed anew to the need and possibility of a different church, a new ecclesial imaginary, through the witness of survivors and strangers, those neglected and cast out, the experience of the pandemic and imagination of the new. It is thus truly a time of crisis and kairos that we inhabit, in which we enjoy a graced opportunity to reimagine how we might fit together and become a good and better church in its function and flourishing in service of our world. Responding, if you like, to the call of Francis to build something different that's both attentive to the summons of the gospel and human fragility. This is the world in which the Center for Ecclesial Ethics begins its journey. This is the landscape in which an ecclesial ethics can serve to shape and inform our reimagining of a different church, such that the participants in our foundational research seminars entitled Our Church Emerging from COVID, the full report from which can be found on our website, they discerned that a different church would be defined by attentive listening, vulnerable accompaniment, and inclusive discernment. They dreamed of a different church that is defined by transfigured structures of attentiveness and accountability. They dreamed of a different church that begins to more radically imitate the vulnerability of God and appreciate the indwelling of the Spirit within each person. These dreams chime loudly with the synodal invitation of Pope Francis to create a different church, a church that is attentive to the least breath of the Spirit and will keep us from becoming, as he concludes, a museum church that is beautiful but mute, with much past but little future. This is at the heart of our new Center for Ecclesial Ethics at the Margaret Beaufort Institute that we launch tonight, established with the aim of enabling and equipping the church, local and universal, as communities and individuals, through discernment and accompaniment, research and analysis, to become a good and better church in our function and flourishing. A centre that's attentive to the wisdom of the academy and the parish, to the passion of Catholic agencies and wider networks, to the creativity and inspiration of those neglected and marginalised, through which we might untangle and reweave an ecclesial ethics that can enrich our ethical perspective, stretch our ministerial imagination, and expand our ecclesial horizon. So then that our ecclesial ethics can serve as a bridge, for example, to link the gaps between moral theology and canon law, between our espoused and operant ecclesiology, and serve as a vehicle for reimagining norms and practices of discernment and governance across the church. An ecclesial ethics that can help to bring about a good and better church that's more participatory and inclusive, discerning and attentive, accountable and just, vulnerable and compassionate. A church which Jim will help us to explore further in a few moments. This is our dream here at the Center for Ecclesial Ethics, for our service and accompaniment of a different church. But let's not take my word for it. Before we listen to Jim, let's hear some of the dreams for a different church in the voices of some of our companions and friends across the UK. And we hope and I pray that the technology works.
I dream of a different church that everyone feels they can attend. A church that is welcoming and embracing. A church that spots newcomers instantly and gives them a warm welcome. A church for all to make home.
Identity. I dream of a different church that is truly safe. One in which I can walk through the doors fully as my God-made self without looking over my shoulder. A church in which people find it unfathomable that people like me ever left the church because of the way that we've been treated.
I dream of a different church where the leadership of women will be enabled to take its rightful place, and it will become a church which protects, cares for, and supports the flourishing of all life and all creatures, as integral to our common home and life on this planet.
I dream of a church more focused on children, a church where they can no longer be described as barely visible, where their needs and their rights are clearly spelled out, where their agency for their own development is fully recognised, where their spirituality is systematically nurtured, and most of all, a church where they can be safe.
I dream of a different church that can reawaken our understanding of the sacredness of earth and of all life, that can fall in love again with God indwelling in all creation, and that can nurture the healing, holding, and freeing awareness that all life is in God, without separation, for all is exquisitely one in holy mystery.
I dream of a church which returns to the ways of the early church, free of clericalism, lives in harmony with our common home, the earth, and shares our resources justly and equitably.
I dream of a different church that is representative of the different cultures around the world that its congregation belongs to, that creates a space where people with different skin tones, accents, and cultural upbringings can see themselves reflected in the worship, where people of different ages, from the young to the old, can come and be energized and inspired and moved in the same space.
I would like a church that is more moral and less moralizing.
I dream of a different church that is a church of holy wonder, in worship which, in all its diverse forms, lifts us all up in our senses to God, and in marvelling at and enabling the gifts, ministry and authority of every member of the church.
I dream of a church in which women and other previously marginalized peoples are heard and appreciated as full members of the body of Christ.
I dream of a church of closeness, tenderness, compassion, that appreciates and listens to each person, so that we're attentive to the least breath of the Spirit.
I dream of a church that has the courage to embrace the gifts of all its people at every level, so that we can truly be an embodiment of Christ's compassion and healing for our needy world of today.
I dream of a different church that helps me, my family, my loved ones see themselves reflected and appreciated.
I dream of a church that where everyone knows everyone else's name, and where we invite people from outside of the church in.
Thank you.
different voices, dreaming of a different church that's possible through an embrace of an ecclesial ethics of vulnerability, in company with an attentive and vulnerable God. During our lecture tonight, please feel free to submit the questions that arise for you throughout our lecture on the direct message on the Zoom chat pane on your screen, and direct them to Dr. Sue Price. And Sue will chair our Q&A following Jim's keynote lecture this evening. More details at the end of the lecture. So it's without any further ado that I warmly welcome Bridget Allaby, a PhD student here at Margaret Beaufort, to introduce Professor Jim Keenan, to unveil for us the different church that is possible through an embrace of an ecclesial ethics of vulnerability. Thank you, Bridget.
We are delighted to welcome Professor James Keenan SJ to deliver the inaugural lecture of the Center for Ecclesial Ethics this evening. Professor Keenan is the Canisius Chair and Director of the Jesuit Institute at Boston College and Vice Provost for Global Engagement. A Jesuit priest since 1982, he received a licentiate and a doctorate from the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. As the founder of Catholic Theological Ethics in the World Church, Jim chaired the international conferences in Padua, Trento, and Sarajevo. Jim has edited or written 25 books and published over 400 essays, articles, and reviews, and he's presently finishing another book for Polis Press, A Brief History of Catholic Ethics. Thank you, Professor Keenan. You're most welcome.
Thank you, Bridget. Thank you, Liam. Thank you, Anna. Thank you, Sue. Let me get started here. I am absolutely delighted that Anna Abram and Liam Hayes invited me to give this inaugural lecture for their Center for Ecclesial Ethics. I want to thank you both. Years ago, I became worried about teaching ethics. It seemed to me that we were designing courses as if students just needed a number of instructions. Teach them ethics and they will act ethically. But I began to see, as others did, that some students were responsive to the need for moral assistance and others were not. Why was it that if they took the same material, some responded to human need and others did not? I began to wonder about the failure to respond. Failing to respond in the first place seems to be the predominant failure in human history. At least it appears that way in the Bible. People do not fail having responded or having tried to respond. Rather, they fail beforehand. They fail to bother to respond in the first place. The priest and the Levite pass by the man on the road in the Good Samaritan parable. The goats don't see the hungry and the naked in the Last Judgment. And the rich man literally steps over hungry Lazarus. None of them bother to respond. Is there something that starts the ball rolling? Is there something that precedes the act of conscience that considers what I am to do? Is there something we are not forming that eventually gets one in the first place to act? I now believe that only after being vulnerably disposed to the other, and then subsequently recognizing the other, do we in conscience act. In other words, I think that there are two steps before acting in conscience. One is being vulnerably disposed, and then two is actually recognizing. These are the preconditions to the moral act. In this presentation on the possibility of a different church, I want to explore first an ecclesial culture that resists vulnerability and recognition. Then I want to cultivate more an appreciation for vulnerability and recognition. And finally, I want to look at models of vulnerability, recognition, and accompaniment as signs of a different church. So the first point, hierarchicalism. For years, I have argued that we need to train priests and bishops and other ministers in what ethical conduct is. But there has been a resistance to that, that those who write on clericalism rightly identify. That clericalism culture is marked not only by an absence of vulnerability and recognition, but also by a dominance that actively rejects those values. I saw that mandating courses without addressing the toxic underlying culture among the ordained is an exercise in futility. I now believe that the primary problem in the church are the toxic cultures, not only among priests, but more importantly, within the hierarchy. Furthermore, I believe that the reformist focus on clericalism over the last 20 years needs now, in light of additional multitudinous scandals, to shift to hierarchicalism. Though those writing on clericalism insisted that hierarchy were included with priests under this rubric, most of these writers woefully overlooked any sustained critical focus on the episcopacy itself, and almost always defaulted to seminary matters as the area for most needed reform. In their writings on clericalism, episcopal conduct rarely came under review as such. In the interest of time, I ask you to grant me this claim that clericalism invariably focused on the culture of priests. I make a sustained case on this matter in a forthcoming article entitled Hierarchicalism in the upcoming March issue of Theological Studies. As I argue to shift the entire discussion on church reform to examining the toxic culture of hierarchicalism, let me note at the outset that, like clericalism, hierarchicalism is not an attempt to indict the ordained state, but rather to identify the vicious culture that problematizes its ranks. I saw hierarchicalism by reflecting what I call the three waves of sexual abuse. The first wave was the groundbreaking stories that happened here in Boston in 1985. The second wave came again from Boston in 2002, which was occasioned by the release of 10,000 pages of records by Cardinal Bernard Law to a local Boston judge that subsequently became the catalyst to investigate all the cover-up from 1985 to 2002. But then more recently, in 2018, there began a variety of leadership scandals that broke yet again. This more recent set of revelations focused not on priests, but now mostly on the episcopacy. In the United States, for instance, two notable investigations in 2018 prompted this third wave. First, the former Archbishop of Washington, Cardinal Ted McCarrick, was removed from ministry. Then Cardinal Pietro Parolin, the Vatican Secretary of State, issued a 445-page investigation into McCarrick's affairs, which Pope Francis insisted be published, a truly groundbreaking move that provided us with an extensive look at hierarchicalism, a problematic type of culture within the hierarchy that becomes evident when bishops do not opt for vulnerable servant ministry. 2 months later, the Pennsylvania grand jury released its report, having investigated the claims, conduct, and ecclesial mismanagement of sex abuse cases within the six dioceses of Pennsylvania. The report provided the broadest in-depth investigation to date in the United States, particularly in how the hierarchy acted. In the concluding remarks of its executive secretary summary, they write, despite some institutional reform, individual leaders of the church have largely escaped public accountability. Priests were raping little boys and girls, and the men of God who were responsible for them not only did nothing, they hid it all. Many, including some named in this report, have been promoted. Until that changes, they wrote, we think it is too early to close the book on the Catholic Church sex scandal. This third wave gives an unprecedented glimpse at a culture within the episcopacy that bred vices which were much deeper, more powerful, and certainly more global in reach than any form of clericalism, and yet was effectively hidden from view in a way that clericalism was not. But hierarchicalism was exposed not only in the US, but elsewhere. In January 2018, the Chilean bishop's case broke when the Pope publicly defended the Chilean hierarchy. Recall the incredible hierarchical power of the Chilean bishops, who consolidated their ranks while under critique for 9 full years by their victims and other witnesses to the church's scandal. The rift between clericalism and hierarchicalism could be seen specifically on January 15th, 2018, when right after the Pope apologized for, quote, the irreparable damage caused by priests in Chile, he publicly rebuffed and dismissed the longstanding charges of the Chilean laity against the bishops and supported the bishops, the support that no priest would ever see. The Pope said, "There is not one single piece of evidence. It is all slander. Is that clear?" It would not be until Archbishop Charles Scicluna was sent to investigate the long overdue charges against the entire Chilean hierarchy that finally that entity was subject to the type of review that they needed to have. In this way, we saw the toxicity within the Chilean episcopacy. In Australia, the same year, Cardinal George Pell's trial proceeded until he was finally convicted in December 2018 of sexual abuse charges that would later be overturned. Unfortunately, the trial concerning Pell's own conduct diverted the Church of Australia and others from addressing the underlying issues of accountability of church governance that in turn led to such extraordinary accounts of abuse there. In France, Cardinal Philippe Barbarin from Lyon was charged in 2017 while failing to report on the sexually abusive activities of a priest and then convicted in 2019, though overturned on appeal in 2020. Still, his resignation was also accepted by Pope Francis in that same year. Finally, in India, in June 2018, Bishop Franco Mulakalo of Kerala was accused of raping a nun. The case continues to go on today. By 2018, the social structures that protected and granted hierarchy impunity were weakening. One journalist wrote, quote, "After centuries of impunity, cardinals from Chile to Australia and points in between are facing justice in both the Vatican and government courts." Moreover, the journalists reached back to cases before 2018 where other hierarchs were not subject to the procedures filed against McCarrick, Pell, and Barbarin. Specifically, she considered Bernard Law from Boston, Keith O'Brien from Scotland, Gottfried Daniels from Belgium, Hans Hermann Grohe from Austria, and Angelo Sodano from Vatican City. Rightly, these investigations prompted us not to simply look at the priest predators, but rather to look at their superiors. We must do the same yet again and again. Consider, for instance, the past summer of 2021, when Lacroix ran the story of how abusive the Archbishop of Avignon was for the past 18 years, or when the National Catholic Reporter announced the indictment of Cardinal Angelo Bessu for financial improprieties, or when the Associated Press reported the censorship of a Polish archbishop for negligence in oversight regarding sexual abuse. Think now of the further stories again emerging from Poland, or worse, think of the French report. As the BBC reported on the extraordinary French scandal in which 216,000 children were sexually assaulted, they wrote, "The church had not only failed to prevent abuse, but had also failed to report it, at times knowingly putting children in contact with predators." As the head of the inquiry stated, there was a whole bunch of negligence, of deficiency, of silence, and institutional cover-up, adding that the church had shown, quote, "deep, total, and even cruel indifference towards victims." Still, hierarchicalism hides today behind clericalism and scapegoats it as well. Until we identify it as such, we are pawns of its own power games. Until we face with them this problem, we will not see reform. Rightly, We investigate today seminary formation and admissions processes so as to root out the cultures of dominance, indifference, and abuses of power. Certainly, I believe seminaries are to some extent sources of clericalism's actual growth, but the real generativity of clericalism derives from its father, hierarchicalism. Bishops shape their clergy more than seminaries do. We can design any seminary we want, but the seminarians take their marching orders from those hierarchs who give them. Until we look at their culture, we are not going to accomplish significant reform, because what anyone who looks at the state of the church today ought to recognize is that our episcopal leadership is the primary cause of its problems. Moreover, when we begin to appreciate the vicious generativity of hierarchicalism in how it reproduces clericalism in its seminaries, parishes, and dioceses, we ought to see also how it corrupts the cultures of both deacons and women in ministry as they ascend in favor among the ranks of the hierarchy. As anyone who studies corruption knows, vicious cultures emanate from the head. Indeed, what most priests and bishops know well is that the formative pathways for future bishops are, generally speaking, considerably different from those for average priests. Early on, future bishops do not do most of their theology studies in their local or regional seminaries. Rather, they are sent to Rome, where they are examined in a variety of ways. There, in the national residential colleges, they are introduced to others in their generation already being considered for leadership. Friends are created among an elite and talented network of priests who are constantly being vetted by their own ordinaries and by their metropolitans for whether or not they will advance in the hierarchy. There is a formation happening in Rome of a very different kind than what happens in the local seminary. Years ago, Peter Daly authored a witty essay entitled Four Easy Steps to Becoming a Bishop. The steps were, first, apprentice yourself out to a bishop as his personal secretary. Second, get an advanced degree, preferably in canon law. Third, get a Roman connection. This step is essential. And fourth, keep a sharp eye on the weather in Rome, knowing which way the wind is blowing there, and because it helps to adjust your own sails. As Daly suggests, if one visits a national college in Rome, one will see a culture quite different from the local seminary. In the local seminary, there are simply not the opportunities for networking or advancement that one finds in Rome. The true revelation of the third wave is that it finally exposed the real source of this entire crisis. For behind each of the three waves was a hierarchicalism capable of rising with impunity above any sense of accountability. In the third wave, we could see how hierarchical culture exercised its power and networking capabilities from the outset. Moreover, we should not think that dismantling hierarchicalism will be like dismantling clericalism. Indeed, the only way clericalism has still survived today is not because of the power of priests, but because of the powerful connections of the hierarchy. Hierarchicalism seeks the survival of clericalism. The former is the father and promoter of the second. We need then to distinguish the two, not because clericalism is not vicious or problematic, it is. We have to better understand, however, the specific problems of that culture, much more isolated and protected than priests, and certainly more complex, insidious, and driven than we know or acknowledge. It is true that clericalism is a dysfunctional mode of acting, effete, arrogant, deceptive. Yet within the presbyterate, these modes of acting derive more from vanity than power. Priestly clericalism has very little power. Clericalism appeared to enjoy power when priests were able to evade the inquiries of concerned laity. But that was only to the extent that the laity did not yet turn elsewhere for redress. Once the laity discovered solidarity, the law, and the media, the laity saw the illusions of clerical power disappear. But make no mistake, the bishops still have their power, and some do not hesitate to use it. 4 years ago, I was invited by Malta's Archbishop Charles Scicluna to address the causes and solutions of the sexual abuse scandal. There I argued that the primary cause of the sexual abuse scandal was hierarchicalism. Scicluna, who has the lead role in the church on the investigations of sexual abuse and the protections of minors and vulnerable people, in response to my paper, furthered my argument by insisting that accountability keeps leaders vulnerable, but impunity destroys that vulnerability. Scicluna saw accountability as redemptive for the hierarchy and impunity at the root of the comfortable space called hierarchicalism. Removing the structures of impunity and introducing norms for accountability could, from his vantage point, help structurally address the underlying culture. In a way, by granting the hierarchy no canonical or legal alternatives to escape transparency and accountability, he hoped that the bishops would eventually realize that they had to embrace these values, and in doing so, encounter the true vulnerability of their episcopal ministry. In my forthcoming article in Theological Studies, I outlined some of the structural reform measures that both he and Pope Francis have taken to dismantle the toxic culture of the episcopacy. I think that as we go forth living in a different kind of church, that we need to perpetually be mindful of the pervasive toxicity of hierarchicalism, vigilant to the need to curb and unroot it. We need to name it, not to ignore it, but to keep it as that which could undo all that we are seeking to develop. To that end, I propose now that we look at what this culture lacks: vulnerability, the capacity for recognition, and the work of accompaniment. And herein we find a different kind of church. So first, vulnerability. Like many others, when I first thought of vulnerability, I considered it singularly as being in need, as being wounded, as primarily a condition that raises alarm. From the writings of Judith Butler, among others, I began to see vulnerability as more about being open, about being responsible, about being responsive, about having capabilities, about being capacious of another's needs. When I recognize that the word vulnerable does not mean having been wounded, but rather being able to be wounded, then I began to see how it means being exposed to the other. In this sense, vulnerability is the human condition that allows me to hear, encounter, receive, or respond to the other, even to the point of being injured. Being vulnerable is what it means to be human. Indeed, as we will see, believing that we are made in the image of God, and as Liam said, I believe it is precisely out of God's vulnerability that we are made. Being vulnerable should not then be reduced to being precarious. That is, being in an unstable or risky situation where the possibility or the continuation of harm occurs. Butler realizes that too many people think of vulnerability as primarily being in an unstable context. She rather wants us to understand that all of us as human beings are disposed to being vulnerable to one another, and precisely when another is at risk, we vulnerably respond. Wisely, she names precarity as a moment of risk for the vulnerable human. She writes, "Precarity exposes our sociality, the fragile and the necessary dimensions of our interdependency." She makes this distinction between precarity and vulnerability, and that often enough, for instance, when we think of the Good Samaritan parable, the man on the road is in a precarious situation. And what I'll argue in a moment is that it's the Good Samaritan who's the vulnerable one. Butler recognizes how fundamentally foundational vulnerability is. Ethical obligation, she writes, not only depends upon our vulnerability to the claims of others, but establishes us as creatures who are fundamentally defined by that ethical relation. Vulnerability is what defines and establishes us as capable of being moral among one another. Again, emphasizing the priority of vulnerability, she contends, this ethical relation is not a virtue that I have or exercise. It is prior to any individual sense of self. It is not as discrete individuals that we honor this ethical relation. I am already bound to you. And this is what it means to be the self I am. I am called to be receptive to you in ways that I cannot fully predict or control. This emphasis on the priority of vulnerability leads us to recognize that what I want in my students most of all, and what we want in our church leaders first of all, is vulnerability. Butler returns to this priority of vulnerability as prior even to the moan from another in need. She writes, "You call upon me, and I answer. But if I answer, it was only because I was already answerable." That is, this susceptibility and vulnerability constitutes me at the most fundamental level, and is there, we might say, prior to any deliberate decision to answer the call. In other words, one has to be already capable of receiving the call before actually answering it. In this sense, ethical responsibility, she concludes, presupposes ethical responsiveness. Our vulnerability is our answerability. It's what allows and prompts us to recognize, to respond, to communicate, to accompany, in short, to love. When we see vulnerability as distinct from precarity and as an open and responsive capaciousness toward the other, we find greater room for discovering vulnerability in the scriptures. The Good Samaritan is a case in point. It is important for us to remember why Jesus tells this parable. He has just given the commandment to love one another. In response, one of the scribes asks Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" A close reading of the story reveals that Jesus is offering a very surprising answer to the question. At the beginning of the story, we are thinking that the answer to the question, "Who is my neighbor?" must be that man lying wounded on the road. That is what we could now call the precarious one. But by the end of the story, we are no longer looking for the neighbor as the precarious one, but as the vulnerable one who is acting. The scribe rightly identifies at the end the neighbor as the one who shows mercy. Being neighbor is being vulnerable. Like the surprise ending, many of us forget that this parable was never primarily a moral one. Rather, throughout the tradition, many preachers and theologians saw in the story of the Good Samaritan the narrative in miniature of our redemption by Christ. It started with Clement of Alexandria in the second century, then Origen, then Ambrose, and finally Augustine. In all of these cases, the Good Samaritan parable is the merciful narrative of our redemption. And then later, Venerable Bede made it very famous, and then it went all the way to Martin Luther. Preachers and theologians appropriate and modify the narrative of our redemption. The basic allegorical expression of the parable is this, and it'll be very interesting to see how many of you have heard the parable told in this way. The man who lies on the road is Adam, wounded by sin, suffering outside the gates of Eden. The priest and the Levite, the law and the prophets, are unable to do anything for Adam. Along then comes the Good Samaritan, Christ, a foreigner, not one from here, who vulnerably tends to Adam's wounds, takes him to the inn, which is the church, gives a down payment of 2 denarii, which are the 2 commandments of love, leaves him in the inn, the church, and promises to return for him, which is the second coming. But he leaves him with the innkeeper, who sometimes is Paul and sometimes is a pope, according to the different traditions. When he will pay the Samaritan, when he will pay, when he returns in full for the redemption and take the man with him into his kingdom, our end. The parable then is first and foremost not a moral story, but about how we should treat about how we should treat others, but rather it is the central story of our own redemption. That is what Christ has done for us. We are called, if you will, to a mutual recognition of seeing in Christ the one who is vulnerable for us so that we might be saved. The parable is about the scandal of our redemption, yet not about how bad we are, but how vulnerable God in Jesus Christ is. In realizing how vulnerable God is, we recognize our own capacity for vulnerability and therein discover the capacity and the call to go and do likewise, to be the vulnerable neighbor. Human dignity, rooted in the image of God, participates in the vulnerability of God. This insight of our vulnerability being connected to God resonates with Enda McDonough's work, Vulnerable to the Holy in Faith, Morality, and Act. There he begins his treatment on the vulnerability of God. God reveals to us God's self as vulnerable by the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem, his life in Nazareth, his death on Golgotha. The more we recognize God's vulnerability, the more we can see our own. While there is much more to say on vulnerability, I now turn to recognition by first focusing on the psychoanalyst and feminist theorist, Jessica Benjamin, who studied mutual recognition among infants. Mutual recognition is that central experience of infants among other infants. After being the object of the attention of people much bigger than themselves, who they're wondering out who or what these people are, mutual recognition is where an infant finally encounters another who seems much like oneself and yet not. They want to touch the face of the other child. They are fascinated that this child in front of them is just like them, but not them. Benjamin writes, mutual recognition is the most vulnerable point in the process of differentiation, of becoming a person. In mutual recognition, the subject accepts the premise that others are separate, but nonetheless share like feelings and intentions. More recently, she finds the language of vulnerability key for recuperating and restoring the experience of mutual recognition. In mutual recognition, we discover human vulnerability, our connectedness, and our responsiveness. As we mature, the experience of mutual recognition can and should happen time and again as part of our growth as moral agents. The mutual recognition in infancy becomes the foundation for subsequent expressions of due recognition whenever we encounter humanity in its greatest precarity or neglect. From that first recognition, where we vulnerably acknowledge the others and our own humanity, we learn to develop a sense that the other in need is another human being who needs to be recognized as such. The philosopher Patty McQueen explains recognition as an insight and a practice that develops, going first from being an awakening to second making a form of identification, and finally to appreciating a responsible relationship that broadens our self-understanding. McQueen writes, the term recognition has several distinct meanings. First, an act of intellectual apprehension, such as when we recognize we have made a mistake or we recognize the influence of religion on British politics. Second, a form of identification, such as when we recognize a friend in the street. And third, the act of acknowledging or respecting another being, such as when we recognize someone's status, someone's achievement of rights. He writes, the philosophical and political notion of recognition predominantly refers to three, to this third one, and is often taken to mean that not only is recognition an important means of valuing or respecting another, it is also fundamental to understanding ourselves. McQueen's move from recognizing someone familiar to giving recognition to one to whom it is due is, I think, the threshold into the moral life. What we learn in infancy is literally a first lesson. In our vulnerability, we recognize that we are related one to another. Then we move from an awakening to a form of identification. Later as children, we realize that that form of identification calls us to a form of responsiveness, especially when the other is neglected, in need, or oppressed. The awakening to and the identification with another's humanity are therefore the very first steps across the moral threshold. Certainly, in being vulnerable, we have the capacity to encounter and respond to another whose own condition is precarious, as we saw in the Good Samaritan parable. The Samaritan's vulnerability becomes evident in his recognition of the man on the road, a recognition that the priest and the Levite failed to make. It's not unlike in the sexual abuse scandal of those who recognized what was happening and those who didn't. Recognition becomes even more an issue in the prodigal son parable. Like the Good Samaritan parable, this one also first focuses on another's precarity, that is, the younger son. But the issue of vulnerability emerges when recognition takes over the story. There, the father, who recognizes his son in the distance, embraces him, reincorporates him, works to restore all that was unstable, threatened, exposed, and jeopardized, is recognized as like the Good Samaritan, the vulnerable one. But he also remains vulnerable to his older son as well, who does not suffer from precarity, but from dominance and arrogance, which expresses itself in his resentment. Commentators will say that there are very few societies, contemporary societies, with this parable that a son could speak to his father the way this son spoke to his father. It's remarkable how vulnerable the father is to this son's resentment. When he sees his younger son, this father, when he sees this younger son in the distance, he knows that his movement toward that son will surely trigger the older son's own insecurities that were covered up by his dominance. Here then we recognize the father's own vulnerability that anchors both sons. The stability in the story is the vulnerable father as the precarious son returns and the resentful one tries to leave. The enduringly vigilant and attentive and responsive father is so because he is vulnerable. So when the older son refers to his brother as that son of yours, the father responds that the older son has to recognize his brother. This brother of yours was dead and has come to life. But the brother needs to be vulnerable before he can recognize. Without it, due recognition normally does not happen. And once, though, if he does recognize, hopefully he will enter the feast so as to accompany his brother, just as the father does. So let's conclude on accompaniment. I began this presentation with my wondering what it is that we need in order to be morally responsive. Against the backdrop of hierarchicalism, I propose vulnerability that leads to recognition, and I now conclude on accompaniment. Indeed, arriving at accompaniment, we see the two preconditions for it, vulnerability and recognition, realizing hopefully that is what the parables teach us. So too does the sexual abuse scandal, which reveals to us those members of the episcopacy caught in hierarchicalism who chose dominance over vulnerability and therefore became incapable of recognition, even of children and other so-called vulnerable people. Nor do they recognize today the needs of the church. They have become the priest and the Levite in the Good Samaritan parable. There is much more on the connection between vulnerability and recognition that others like Butler, Hilahaka, Daniel Fleming suggest. But here, we need to turn to a conclusion, and that's the start of a different church. A different church that's prompted by vulnerability and recognition that learns to accompany as the Good Samaritan and the father of the prodigal son did. Here too, I suggest that the eloquence of the papacy of Pope Francis is that he makes the same connections between vulnerability and recognition, but then caps the two steps with a third accompaniment. And nowhere does he do it better than an Amoris Laetitia. The real beauty of Amoris Laetitia is that it first calls us to vulnerably recognize the challenges of married and family life, and then invites us into the ministry of accompaniment. Moreover, while some may think that Pope Francis's recent proposal of a set of beatitudes specifically for bishops is his invitation to them to leave hierarchicalism so as to embrace servant ministry, I believe his real gift to the episcopacy is Amoris Laetitia. They can only embrace it if they humbly become vulnerable. In that vulnerability, they could learn to recognize the challenges of the people of God as they are, and in that recognition, to hear the summons to accompany them. But if they learned to recognize others and then to accompany them, they would be halfway there. But they need to receive Amoris Laetitia in the first place, and at least in my country, most have not. Still, this accompaniment is the different kind of church. It is the church of the Samaritan. It is the church of Francis. 3 weeks ago, I called up and spoke at length with Anna and Liam about my talk. I told them that I always found in the Catholicism of the United Kingdom a remarkably hospitable community that bred a type of church vulnerable and capable of recognition and inclined to accompaniment. Let me conclude on the signs that I have seen in the UK. In 1994, almost 30 years ago, I was a member of the Institute for Advanced Studies at Edinburgh University and living in the Jesuit parish of St. Aloysius. Sister Aylred Timmons, who I think is on this today, invited me to work in her community of St. Catherine's, where in 1992, the Sisters of Mercy converted their famous convent into a well-known homelessness center, where today 200 people are served daily. I remember on my many walks in Edinburgh with Aylred that wherever we went, homeless people would greet Aylred. Such was her familiarity and theirs with one another. Now there was a different kind of church. Thinking of Aylred's community in Edinburgh, I am reminded too of another Sisters of Mercy project, the Women at the Well at King's Cross, that accompanies and supports women trapped in the sex slave trade. That center is a different kind of church. While in Edinburgh, through Fergus Kerr, I would be regularly invited into the Dominican community of St. Albert's Catholic Chaplaincy, where again, vulnerability, their recognition and accompaniment was in evidence. That same year, through Charles Curran, I was introduced to Kevin Kelly, who brought me in 1994 to Liverpool regularly. The ever thoughtful and hospitable Kelly invited me to a weekend in Chester, where along with Bernie Hoos, I got the chance to meet for the first time Linda Hogan and Julie Clegg, two friendships that changed my life. Kelly continuously promoted the type of church we imagine. He had co-founded the Association of Teachers of Moral Theology in 1967, and in the late 1990s became a co-founding member of the International Catholic Theological Coalition for HIV/AIDS Prevention, which launched me in my work in HIV/AIDS and introduced me to CAFID and Trocara. In both, as in many Catholic ministries in the UK, and I saw here Gillian Patterson, I find the model of vulnerability, recognition, and accompaniment in a very UK way of being church. For instance, CAFID defines their mission is to work alongside the world's poorest people. I knew during those years when the hierarchy was trying to figure out how it could or could not work with on HIV/AIDS prevention strategies, some of the best voices came from these two agencies and their peers who were accompanying those most at risk or infected with the virus. Like CAFID and Trocara, the people at Caritas similarly embody the pattern of vulnerability, recognition, accompaniment of a different kind of church. Later, Kelly, in that same year, in plans with Cardinal Basil Hume, again invited me, as well as 15 other moral theologians, into a three-day conversation with some 15 bishops about Veritatis Splendor. Enda McDonough, Kevin Kelly, Bernie Hoos, and many others, like Julie Clegg and Linda Hogan, were there. But what was most remarkable was that it was a more different kind of church than I ever witnessed, mostly because of the animating and gentle, hospitable spirits of Kelly and Hume. Of course, much like Sister Aylred, Cardinal Hume knew the homeless as well, and the Cardinal Hume Center and the passage today stand as signs that a different kind of church is possible. Later again, through Kelly, I met Martin Prendergast and Julian Filikowski. Together with John Fuller, I became involved in their project that was published in Opening Up, Speaking Out in the Church. This was indeed a collection of recognition. Later, Martin was kind enough to introduce me to LGBT Catholics Westminster Pastoral Council, who recognized what so many refuse to acknowledge, that is sexual diversity. Today, on a much larger scale, there is Quest that has as its mission to proclaim the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ for the advancement of the Christian religion among LGBT plus Catholics. This too is a form of church that again vulnerably recognizes and accompanies. These multitudinous forms of church throughout the UK are the beacons for our future, but they have been here for decades already. This is what we need to recognize. But here I want to finally finish on the wonderfully vulnerable imagination that we find in Catholics at UK universities. As I said, it was the Dominicans who invited me into the University of Edinburgh in 1994. But in 2007, it was Paul Murray, a year before the UK's first Center for Catholic Studies was founded, invited me to Durham. Like Durham today, Oxford, both the Dominicans at Blackfriars with their Las Casas and Aquinas Institutes, and the Jesuits with Nick Austin's leadership at Campion Hall, we see again vulnerability, recognition, and accompaniment as the ways such communities of faith arise and serve within university structures. And now, today, the Margaret Beaufort Institute of Theology, nearly 30 years of vulnerably recognizing and accompanying lay theologians, launches the first Center for Ecclesial Ethics, and in doing so, models yet again for us a different kind of church. Thank you.
Jim, thank you. Thank you for such a moving and energizing lecture. At the beginning of your lecture, you pose for us the question, what do we need in order to be morally responsive, both as persons, but especially as church? And through your experience and expertise, you have authoritatively drawn out for us the symptoms and roots of a hierarchicalism that has wounded and disfigured our church. But you've also reimagined for us a different church that our scriptures and our Pope call us to embrace. A different church that is prompted by vulnerability and recognition into an accompaniment like the Samaritan. A Samaritan church, the seeds and signs of which are all around us and which serve as bright beacons, you conclude, for our future as a different church. For this tonight, we are most grateful. For your sharing of the richness and depth of your experience and wisdom. And so now we have an opportunity to explore this in more detail through questions and dialogue. So if you have a question, a point that you wish Jim to clarify or develop a little further, please type this into the live chat on your Zoom panel at the bottom. And if you can direct that to Sue Price, direct DM her. And given that we're such a large group this evening, Sue will present these questions on our behalf to Jim. So in the meantime, whilst we each reflect and prepare and we collate our questions for Jim, for the next few minutes, we have the opportunity to listen and to see some beautiful art from Pavlina, one of our PhD research students here at Margaret Beaufort, after which we shall open our Q&A session. So thank you, Pavlina, who will now introduce her artwork to us.
Hello all. This artwork, called Conception, talks about receiving or conceiving a word. It's processing, letting it grow in one's heart and mind, and advancing it to happening. The element of allowing something to happen is crucial here. This power to perform was given to human beings by God in order to collaborate in the act of creation or recreation as human counter-movement of creation. It deals with the human ability to give life not only in the literal sense, but in the figurative one. I hope that watching this video collage will help you to process what we have just heard and develop it into acts of love and justice.
I dream of a different church.
Thank you.
Welcome back, and thank you, Pavlina, for this most beautiful artwork, more of which can be found and seen at Pavlina's website, the address for which we will show at the end of our evening. But now I hand over to Sue Price, the co-principal of Margaret Beaufort, to chair our questions and chat with Jim. So over to you, Sue.
Thank you very much, Liam. And thank you very much indeed, Professor Keenan. I have several questions for you. I'll do my best to group them together. Apologies to everyone, as I know that we won't have time for all the questions. We'll do my best, and we'll keep all the questions so that we can send them on to Professor Keenan later on, and Liam will be collating them. So let's start with this whole thing about vulnerability. Several people have commented on that. And one of the questions that's come up is whether the emphasis on vulnerability, has it got significance about autonomy as seen as central to some form of ethics? And as someone else points out, the Good Samaritan had autonomy because they had money. But I wonder if you'd like to start there.
Yeah, I don't think that the Good Samaritan, is, people may think of that. I think that the Good Samaritan is capacious. That's what I'm trying to work with in all of this. And all human beings are capacious in some way or another. When one looks at the story of the Good Samaritan and sees the priest and the Levite, one doesn't think that it's the Samaritan with the money, nor do they think he's the one with the power. As a matter of fact, he's the most unaffected by the social structures around him because he's an alien from them. So he's coming in fairly vulnerable. And that's what I'm really interested in, is that as a matter of fact, I think this has gospel depth. I think that vulnerability, you know, we're formed by the cross of Christ. Our church in the first millennium were formed in the forms of crosses. You know, we initiate our liturgies in that way. I'm interested in a church that identifies with the Christ crucified. This is what Bonhoeffer was calling us to during the war. This is what all prophetic voices are constantly raising up. Now, what's the concept that we can use in contemporary language, and what are the ways that philosophers and theologians are looking at as what it is that prompts a human being to finally respond? And there is a consensus about vulnerability. So I don't think that the vulnerability, I mean, I see two people on the question of autonomy, but to tell you the truth, this is the first time I've ever seen anybody raising that as an issue. Certainly he has some capacity, but the capacity, the real capacity, passed by. This is a man who's not from there, who's gonna have to return back. This is a person who's going to have to figure out how he's going to do that. This is not a person who has the connections that the priest and the Levite had. So to be able to see in the Samaritan all this capacity that's analogous to what's just passed by, I find striking. So I would just say I'm not going to deny that the Samaritan may have some capabilities more, but he is not from there. He's not certainly recognized as really deserving to be there. He is considered an alien. And we don't know much about his wealth other than that he uses it for this man. We don't say that he just took a little part of his wealth. I mean, this is constructive, hyperbole.
Okay, thank you. But carrying on with that discussion on vulnerability, someone's asked, do we need to add curiosity to vulnerability, to add openness through vulnerability?
Well, what I'm always playing with is a yin and yang between recognition and vulnerability. Vulnerability is the capacity and recognition is the act. These are mutually engaged. So we attribute vulnerability to the Samaritan because he recognizes and then acts. we attribute vulnerability to the father because he recognizes the issues of both of his sons. So this connection between vulnerability is something that Butler and Hilahaka and a number of other people, I think, are rightly doing. But I tried to go into scriptural texts to show that there is a certain way that if we look at these texts, they can help us to see further how it is connected to our way of being disciples. So, yeah, that's the way so, you know, curiosity, recognition, I'm fine with either, but what we're talking about right now is recognition. Curiosity has an idleness about it. There may be a sense that one would say wonder or awe, you know, these are also different connections. And I would say that I've been working on what do I think are the virtues for being vulnerable and what are the virtues for being for recognizing. And I think that the virtue of vulnerability is humility. And what I do here is what I think of it is as analogous to the humility of Mary in the Magnificat, that it's a familiarity with my place in God's world. And that if you're really vulnerable, and Augustine, you know, he said, you know, tells us that if you want to know how the life of virtue is, first be humble. And you want to know the second step, be humble. And the third step, be humble. Why all that? I think he's actually talking about something analogous to vulnerability, that you know you have a place in God's world and you are able to see that you're connected with one another. So the virtue that I like to put with vulnerability and what I develop elsewhere is humility. And in recognition, I think the virtue is really vigilance, which is a good 16th century English. In all the spiritual manuals, the main virtue, even Erasmus has vigilance. And vigilance is, you know, this disposition to see what's on the horizon, to see what others don't see. The great shame of our world is how we overlook. The great shame of the scandal is how our bishops live in a culture that allowed them to overlook everything that was happening and to shamelessly ignore it, in a way having protective blinders. So I think that what we need in a different kind of church is a new humility, not a kowtowing humility, the humility of a Mary who proclaims her place in God's world in the Magnificat. That strikes me as a good humility. And a vigilance that's really powerful and able to recognize those who are alienated and those who are not being treated in the church. Whence why I, at the end, I'm constantly talking about all the different ways we can be church. And I do want to say, though, I could go on with a list in the UK of how I found in among Catholics in the UK this tendency to form groups that are responsive to people in need. And these groups have withstood, you know. Aylward's, you know, center started in 1992, and it's still going in full force. So it's not like these were temporary moves. They're all different ways of being vigilant. And that's how that started, was being vulnerable to and able to recognize what the rest of the city of Edinburgh really needed to do. And that was to recognize that there were people who needed shelter, who needed showers, who needed food.
Thank you. But I'm going to pick up on that. You've begun talking about women and about Mary there. And one of the questions that's come through is being vulnerable and accompanying within this church structure is fine, is all very well, but where are the women in the structure?
Oh yeah.
I'd like to add to that by another question that's come in about how do we start the conversation on women or laymen as cardinals?
Oh yeah, I've been talking about women as cardinals now for a long time because I'm actually interested to have women at the table to decide about the whole question on ordination. I don't think that we should say that we'll get a woman ordained and therefore she'll have power. We need to unhook the relationship between power and leadership and ordination. That is an issue that we really need to unhook. To say that ordination gives you leadership, dear God, where did this come from? This is just a cultural connection that has to be, you know, further understood. What we need to do is we need to recognize what constitutes leadership in our church and to see in many different ways. And until we address hierarchicalism, any question about women in the church will not be resolved. The entire block is due to this vicious culture that's within the hierarchy that was formed in these Roman colleges and it perdures to today. The way that they can, our leadership can just, our clerical leadership, but I want to say our hierarchical leadership, manages to, in any different way, to raise out or to keep women from voting in synods or whatever. Constantly, that mentality is coming from somewhere, and we need to identify that somewhere. And that is the issue that is blocking everything. Because most people, when they sit down, recognize if they have any sense of fairness or the grace of Christ or the cross of Christ, or that they've been redeemed not by themselves, but by Jesus Christ, recognize how Christ was with women around him. That Mary is there in the upper room, you know, that Luke 8, we see the women are there with him. We see at the cross, we see more women there than men on the way. We see throughout this, we recognize the role of leadership of the women. We recognize Mary Magdalene being the first witness to the resurrection. What else do we need to know that there are grounds, theological, scriptural, from Revelation grounds, for women's leadership in the church? Why don't we have it? Because our hierarchy does not recognize this.
Thank you. And I'm going to finish with one last question. If hierarchy is the problem, how will the Pope's synodal process work if the bishops decide what to put forward?
That's why people like me are writing these things right now. That's why you have a center for ecclesial ethics. This is not going to be like everybody's gonna say, oh yeah, we've been waiting to hear this news. We're going into a new phase that the Pope is engaging us to say, can people like me, can people like Anna, can Liam, can each of you say what you want to say in the church? Now, if synodality is about being able to say something among one another, you know, if that's the model of church, then that's what it should be. But if somehow there is going to be this silencing and selecting going on yet again, then what we're going to see, I think, is that that synodality is going to be as vacuous as anything that hierarchicalism will keep its claws on.
Thank you so much. I'm going to hand back to Liam now.
Thank you. Thank you, Sue. And thank you, Jim, and our questioners, for a truly inspiring, for an energizing and rich lecture this evening that's not only marked the launch of the Center for Ecclesial Ethics, but opened up before us a different church that is possible. One that you define by accompaniment rather than domination, by service rather than power. A different church prompted by vulnerability through humility and recognition through vigilance, but also for opening up more clearly for us the contribution that ecclesial ethics can make to this different accompanying church and going to the root of the problem with the evil of hierarchicalism, as you so potently described this evening. So thank you. But now, you see, given the depth and the breadth of Jim's lecture, there are so many questions that feel left that we continue to need to explore. And they're popping up on the screen as I'm speaking right now, which is a really healthy sign of a good lecture, I think. And we would really welcome these further questions and suggestions for the research and work of the Centre here in the UK that you believe are worth pursuing following our lecture and dialogue this evening. What are these issues that we need to explore further, that we need to take further in our dialogue to enable everyone to be able to say what they want to say? So that is something of our plea for you this evening, is to forward these to me at the email address which comes up at your screen. And we will do the best to fit these into the heart of our discernment and planning at the Center for Ecclesial Ethics, which is a servant and accompanier of our wider church. We would like to send you an email after this conference, if you're willing, with post-conference documents and the link to the video of tonight's lecture, which we encourage you to share far and wide and make the subject of your discussions, perhaps in your synodal conversations, in your local communities and beyond the structured conversations. If you don't wish to receive, then please do get in touch and we promise we won't bother you. Otherwise, I wish to thank you for joining us this evening, and also in particular to Bridget and Pavlina, to Joseph and Sue, Margaret and Mary Stella for their support in bringing our lecture together this evening, a truly collaborative effort, and to Anna for her continued support and encouragement. And of course, to Jim for his wonderful insight and authoritative encouragement of our work, both personally and in our new Centre for Ecclesial Ethics. So thank you, Jim, and thank you to each and every one of you for joining us this evening. Your comments that continue to flow on the screen will continue to inform our dialogue and our research as we go forward. So I wish you and yours a very peaceful Advent season, and hand back to Anna to draw our evening to a close.
Thank you, Liam. I just would like to add to Liam's words of thanks my own gratitude to Jim for his truly powerful, courageous, and truly thought-provoking lecture, to my colleagues whom Liam has already mentioned for their work for this event, to Liam for his dedicated and creative work and really passionate commitment to the Center. And I thank each of you for joining us today. We look forward to seeing you again in the near future as companions on the journey towards a different and vulnerable church. So have a pleasant evening. Goodbye.